Today in our STEM studio, Brian will tell his story of the zigzag module.
One challenge of making a paper roller coaster properly is to get the angle right. If it is too flat, the marble might not make it. If it is too steep, the marble can move too fast and fly off the track.
Also, a steep track uses up limited height, which means that the kids don't get to build as much.
That's a challenge that we want the kids to solve themselves. But we also want to make sure that every kid can make some progress. So, I experimented with giving the kids one piece of track that was already taped to a card at the correct angle.
Brian's experiments ultimately led to the zigzag module, which is a very fun module.
With this, every kid can get one track right. However, it is rather boring. To make it more interesting, I tried using two pieces of track.
That's not right, but we get the idea.
Then I stopped and thought about it for a while. First of all, this is way too flimsy. Second, even two pieces of track is not interesting enough. Third, engineering requires both synthesis and analysis. Synthesis is making things. Analysis is figuring out how things are made.
How often do engineers switch between synthesis and analysis?
They do it all the time. It is like eating with a fork and a knife. Anyway, this kind of module has got the potential for kids to figure out something, but it is too simple. And it is too easy to see everything. There is not enough mystery.
So then what?
I tried several ways to use three pieces of track between two index cards, and I added more paper around the outside to make the module more sturdy and to keep the inside hidden. But the problem was that those parts were too hard to make.
So you got stuck.
For inspiration, I went back to first principles. I looked around the office supply store and tried to imagine how various materials could be used to solve this problem. I was using 3x5 index cards, but I also found 5x8 index cards.
That does not look like an index card.
This is actually cut from a file folder, but its dimensions are 5 inches by 8 inches.
Alright.
If you turn it sideways, you can fit a 3x5 card across the top. Then there is 1 inch of space, which is exactly the width of the track. Then there is room for another 3x5 card, and another inch at the bottom. Instead of taping cards together, I could fold a larger card to be the back, bottom, front, and top of the module.
Where does the grid come from?
Well, to solve a completely different problem with a different module, I started cutting up file folders that have a grid printed on the interior. Then, I put those ideas together and realized that I could cut it to the 5x8 size, or give it a little extra room so that I have extra material for the sides of the module. This material is 7x8.5 inches. So, let me show you how to make it. First, I cut the sides. Only part of it will be attached. The rest will be folded to make the interior. Then, we have two squares worth of overlap. I'll use my pen as a stylus to make a nice fold. So that's our two squares to tuck. Then, I'll fold four squares to make the top of the box. Then, coming down another 3 inches, which is 12 squares, I'll choose this grid line to be the line between the back and bottom. Then, 4 more squares down is the line to fold between the bottom and front of the box. There's our front. In fact, it is exactly 3x5. To make the box, I will snip and turn it sideways to make one top corner. And likewise, this will be the other top corner. Now you can see the box come together. But, it is just a box, without anywhere for the marble to go.
So, how will this become a zigzag module?
First of all, I'm not actually ready to tape this part yet. When making these modules, we need to cut, then fold, and then tape as the last step. There will be three zigzag ramps. The marble will come into the right, then to the left, and then to the right again. The first ramp is cut from the top of the box. I will cut the end of the ramp. This little area is a detail that I will get to later. And then this is the beginning of the ramp. Now I will free up that section of the top of the box so that it can be folded down as an entrance ramp. Over here is an internal ramp that points the marble back that way. It will stop the marble from exiting and make it go back. And then on this side, the same thing. Another internal ramp that redirects the marble to go back that way. And then the marble will roll on the bottom of the box. There is an opening so that the marble can come out. There's also an opening here, but it doesn't matter. Now I'll go back and tape the top corners. For the internal ramps, I leave some thickness because it makes the module more sturdy. To tape the ramps, keep in mind that the marble diameter is 3 grid squares. So, I will tape the top ramp here. I tape the ramps by twisting to make the part flatter and then applying the tape. The third ramp is taped directly to the bottom of the box. Coming back to this detail, I will use a small piece of tape to connect the front side of the ramp to the top. Next, we take a leap of faith to close the box. Half of that bit of tape holds the front closed while we tape up the sides. Now, we are ready to test with a marble. It goes in, and it comes out. If you had an X-ray, you could see that there is a ramp there, another ramp coming back, and then one at the bottom. It makes a very nice sound as you hear the marble hit each ramp. There is a bit of mystery for kids to figure out. Here you can see a ramp, but you can't see how the marble gets to it. Here you see a dead end. And here you see that the marble goes in, but you cannot see where it goes. I'll add a little more tape to make the module more kid-proof.
Brian, thanks so much for showing us how to make this module and explaining the thinking that went into it.
My pleasure. I'm so glad you liked it. Until next time. Keep it rolling.